Hello, Greg. This is Mr. Sneaky Man. I listened to your Gordon White show, and I'm one of your subscribers. And I listened to your post podcast monologue. And when you said about Homer coming down the escalator and then Donald Trump in real life coming down the escalator in the same way, I instantly Googled it, and it blew my mind. Later, I was so jumping out of my skin the entire day about that. That when I got home from work, I started checking it out, including going back to season 11 of The Simpsons. There's no escalator ride in Bart to the Future, the one that they claim that the escalator ride is in. So I started Googling it, and Snopes said it was fake, and they had a link to the actual Simpsons animation, and it's just a short clip made after Donald Trump's announcement. So they animated it from the video taken from his announcement. That's where the video comes from. So we were both had. Greg, I love you so much that I didn't even check it out before I talked to my friend Ab on Fakeologist. And from now on, I should just check.
The planet's puppet masters almost surely have a plan. There's clearly maybe something there beyond the realm of man. And until you've thoroughly tested every last close trusted view, I find the more you think you know, the less you really do.
That's true, Dr. Zaius.
Where would we be without THC? Cause we know they're lying to us, just don't know to what degree. Yeah, where would we be without THC? The highest side chat show, Greg Carwood Company.
Here we go, higher side chatters, drinking a little drink, smoking a little smoke from sunny San Diego, a beautiful day in the neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Won't you be mine? I'm Greg Carlwood, your humble stoner host, and today's show is pretty interesting. It's a little shorter than most because our guest was having terrible luck with his internet connection, followed by some apparent problems with a van out front towards the end. You'll see. But I've had a few episodes recently that have gone long, so this isn't the end of the world. But he's had such amazing experiences, I had to get him on. I only wish we could have talked about the details of those experiences a bit more. But you'll hear me list them off in his introduction, and he's a guy that's been recommended in the Plus Forum 3 or 4 times, which is the first place I look when I need recommendations. Dr. Richard Allen Miller, he's also quite a character and a bit hard to keep on track at times, but that's what happens with a strong personality, and you gotta love a strong personality. I also wanted to mention up front a little bit of good news. The THC app is done. And it works great for about 90% of people using iPhones for both the free and the plus versions of the show. The most common issue with the app is for plus members not being able to sign in with their username and password. A simple password change has solved about 8 out of 10 of those types of cases. You can do that yourself from the link on the subscription page or email the higher side chats team at gmail.com. Also, relook at that help page if you're on Android. All new step-by-step instructions with screenshots on how to get it using the most convenient apps. If for some reason you have Plus and you have an Android phone but you aren't using one of those free apps, it really is a much easier way to listen. Check those step-by-step instructions on the help page if help is needed. Now, apps are really the sort of thing that you do need ongoing developer support for. And the guy who was kind enough to make it for us did it on the house and wants to remain anonymous, so he isn't going to be able to provide that ongoing support. So I'm limited in what I can do to help right now, and there are issues. But it's a step in the right direction, seems to be working for the overwhelming majority of people, and he got us there faster than we would have otherwise. So I'm really grateful, and I'm getting to the point where at this stage in the game, for the website and now the app, I'm going to need to get a developer that can fine-tune some things, implement those last bits that are a little bit over my head, and maybe someone out there can help me. Email me if you think that might be the case. But let's dive into this show. We are all over the map today, people. Entheogens, magic, military intelligence, Nazi bases in Antarctica, and a whole lot more to quench your conspiratorial thirst with the man who knows the plan, Dr. Richard Allen Miller. Enjoy.
Acting and park it, tune in and spark it, 'cause Greg's about to open up your mind.
starting on what we thought we knew for certain, so we can see the world with a brand new set of eyes. You're listening to The Higher Side.
All right, people, as we wade through the weird waters of the world and throw our spotlight in the many areas that the mainstream is quarantined in darkness, we find that a better understanding of life and the universe waits for us on that road less traveled. Well, today we have a guest who's been living on that road most of his life and has had accomplishments, experiences, and interactions with notable people that will leave a lot of jaws on the floor. At 20 years old, his mother was being convinced by Timothy Leary to let the young prodigy take part in LSD studies. In college, he received more degrees and doctorates than I can name in fields like physics, hypnotherapy, and Jungian psychology. He pursued the path of hermetic scholar and has risen through the ranks of the OTO, worked on high-level projects for Boeing and DuPont out of grad school, taught metaphysics at Harvard for 11 years, trained Navy SEALs for human optimization using biofeedback, worked on ESP and psychic effects for military intelligence, was hired for research projects by Buckminster Fuller, spent time working with John Lilly on psychedelic communication with dolphins, has seen the Antarctic Nazi base with his own two eyes, and has written more books than there are days in the week, with titles like ESP Induction Through Forms of Self-Hypnosis, The Magical and Ritual Use of Herbs, The Modern Alchemist, A Guide to Personal Transformation, and Power Tools for the 21st Century. Another guest who's probably done more today than I've done in my lifetime, 72 years young, Dr. Richard Allen Miller. How the hell are you?
Well, when you put it like that, I gulp. How do you follow something like that? That's bullshit. I'm going bald.
Oh, me too.
Yeah, but mine's from unnatural causes. I pulled it out.
Man, impressive resume, and it is a real pleasure. Obviously, you've done a lot in your life and worked with people that I would have loved to have met but never had the chance. I am in awe.
How old are you?
30.
You're 30. Well, yeah, gotcha. You've got your own tools to do. Last man standing kind of thing. Good luck with that. Well, you're here to get to witness the end of days. That's what your higher form chose.
Yeah, bittersweet reality, but I guess I'm ready. But what I like about you is that you seem to have weaved back and forth between magic and science, which some people think of as oil and water, but there was many wild things going on in the 60s and 70s that were a lot more out in the open than they are now.
Well, every single bureaucracy, including the Republican Party, has an occult secret cell within it. That's been for almost 300 years, maybe 350 years. Golden Dawn attracted all the scholars of Europe and was held to be for elite only. Now, when I came out of graduate school, what happened was I was assaulted, rushed. Yeah, you know, like for both Skull and Bones and Bohemian Grove, I had to armor up. It could be like going out without any catechism into a Christian universe. You have to have armor on. And if you're not prepared for that. And what happened was I'm a polymath, obviously. And so I became a world authority in Hermetic Kabbalism, Merkaba, and old school physics. You know, magic is actually one way of seeing it is advanced physics with a mystery school. And you don't have to know how something works, like a woman driving an automobile, in order to function and use that as a tool, you know, moving from here to there and whatever. It's all in metaphor, and that's what I'm writing about this very moment is Gregory Bateson. And what is your metaphor but to serve your paradox? And the way we distort that is we have a meadow with two oxes in it. Your meadow is for your two ox. Get it? Never mind. If that is what metaphor is and how we associate one thing to another in the way we group content. That's John Bohm, implicate order, similar differences and different similarities.
Yeah,
like that.
You're a wealth of info, and I mentioned Leary in the intro, and you've said that you knew Ram Dass before he was Ram Dass, and you even spent a time or two with McKenna.
You mean, how would we best put that? Still Here. That's his latest book. Yeah, that's the way it goes for old parts, man.
What were those years like?
Which years?
Hanging out with Timothy Leary and knowing Ram Dass.
Here's how this works. It's about the nature of time and your future and specific timelines that are generated from your past. Your past is the primary wave that is formed like a cavitation ball when you live in the moment. When you are in the groove where everything flows, you are close to purpose. Intent is actually what happens at the end of the day and is slightly different than purpose, except at your level of consciousness. And at some point when you get caught up in the moment, it becomes sacred over profane. And that is a specific future, talking and having dialogue in that moment and literally changing the past. At the time I did Sealed, what's been like with being with Timothy Leary? Well, we were all just hanging out, getting high. Ha ha. No, it wasn't like that. It was the moment. And that moment formed a cavitation ball of what Robert Ornstein calls time as a duration of consciousness. It is the way you group memory. And that part of it is how, when you find at this moment, listening to my words, finding significance, that's how your future is talking to your moment right now and literally changing it. At the time I did Navy SEALs, they were called SEAL Corporation. Navy SEALs didn't exist. That's become a, what is that, urban myth, modern myth of super soldier. Super soldier as a term didn't even exist back then. And just as another time capsule, it would be like we knew about aliens back then, but we were more worried about what the Russians were doing. That's the truth of it. Mm-hmm. And so while there were alien artifacts, what were the Russians doing with them? That's where we were concerned. Now we have all kinds of rice Kex, you know, with all these different flavors and whatever they put in that multi cereal. It's life is like a box of those. And that's where the metaphor comes in, is watching how it changes over time, like Antarctica.
Yeah.
And Fulford and whatever else is going on out there at that moment. when you re-listen to my words on this that you're recording right now, each time you will get something different. That's where the richness and the quality of the moment lies. And it really is like a cavitation ball. Your inner feminine part of you, the wise old woman, the higher self, the androgynous other side of you is like a cavitation with a white hole and a black hole. And it's a metaphor again. And how you choose to find significance in my words at each moment, which is different, listening to what I have to say, because I'm in that groove, it's going to have a richness that connects you to yourself. I just got an email. That means my internet is back up again.
Nice.
It's going back and forth, man. It's awful.
Yeah, I hear you. And that was well said. I do get that. And something I hoped you could elaborate on was your past with John Lillier working with dolphins.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's a Carl Sagan project. Everybody watching Dolphin and their clicks and whistles, even in the movie, our man Flint, he had a language. You know, sitting there being able to talk to Dolphin. Our man Flint, there's an old one after James Bond. Dolphin, actually, their clicks and whistles are a more advanced form of language than even Hebrew. They brought me in. I was in Berkeley for, oh shit, I think maybe 10 days. And within 10 days, I had been recording and the sounds and looking for structure in the cadence form using scopes and, you know, old shit like that. And I noted that there was encoding and code cipher within their language. Their language had less redundancy than even Hebrew.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, with Sefer Yetzirah and how you relate sounds to words, the dolphin are possibly 10 times more efficient in their language as a form of Clifford algebra. And because of the way they compress it in sonar, a lot is transferred in a burst and a lot of information. And that's because their brain is actually physically bigger than man. And who's higher on the food chain? Orca has a cerebral cortex that's twice the size of man. And that mammal, cetacean, is actually firing 60% of it at any given moment, which by definition would say that that orca was God. Not our God, but that which cannot be known. As a definition. And now I'm coming in as a biblical scholar. I'm a Tzaddi in Hermetic Kabbalism, and I'm a physicist. You can't kid a kidder. And I am here to tell you, we don't have a clue. In my opinion, there may be as many as, at this moment, at least four mammals that are more evolved technically than man. And when we talk about they have all four have bigger brain cases. Turns out they're cetacean, and all four of them are better designed for their habitat than man is and his biosphere. So what does that suggest in terms of hierarchy and life form? And here's the last piece of that curveball. When I have seen orca hunting dolphin, that means it's about food chain.
Right.
How's that feel?
Yeah, man.
Yeah, not food from the gods, but food for the gods.
So you got dolphin and orca in there. What are the other two?
Well, your pilot whale and manatee. All four have those. Yeah, those four are mammals. And now, then you have gorillas. Gorilla doesn't have as big a brain case, but an elephant does. Hmm. And I've seen an elephant be able to paint itself. In Cambodia, that it shows that that mammal has a better sense of being observed from another. And the way it painted itself has a far deeper awareness of its own presence than we do. So, you know, and dogs. Why do we love dogs? Because they're closer to spirit. They love unconditionally, like a Down syndrome type of child.
Mm-hmm.
They have a type of length, girth, and width of experience that we're only just now tuning into. Our ego is pretty much what dominates the physical plane. I know it does for me, and I'm constantly witnessing and working on trying to step back from that part of it. It's impossible because the physical plane is where I've come to be sick spiritually.
Boom.
That's a metaphor.
Yeah. And now, because you've done so much and you've gone deep into the study of magic and had a bunch of psychedelic experiences, what can you tell us about entities in other realms?
I would say that if imagination is reality, then we are creating our own apocalypse and aliens with our imagination. Of course they're real. How could they not be?
Right.
You know, if man's awareness is verging on, fourth grade, and there's, you know, high school ahead with undergraduate school and postdoctoral and sabbatical, get a grip. You know, if you can conceive of something, how could it not be? And that is exactly what I'm writing about on the nature and structure of water.
Hmm. So do you think multidimensional entities and spirits and things like the higher guardian angel, are these all just parts of the self?
probably in your concept of it. And then, just like in the old Bibles, talking about the veils of Isis, Ain, Ensof, and Ensof Ur, like Bob Dylan said, everybody's got to serve somebody. I noticed in the old Bibles, they talk about several gods. There's Yahweh, and then Yod-Heh-Vah-Heh, and then the Christians kind of say, well, it's the same thing, but not really any more than Enlil and Errol and those sons are Cain and Abel. You know, it's always in metaphor. And the word is not about something outside of yourself. Truth lies within. And that's how you resonate with that statement, not the statement itself. And definitions, which change from one generation and century to another. The Bible itself is inspired. It is not absolute. What's absolute is in how you interpret it. That is where it all lies. And that's where the imagination makes multidimensional. You know, angels and demons. What is a demon? A demon is a lesser entity than you, which means it might be your shadow. Oh, guess what? We do call it the shadow in Jungian psychotherapy. And so there is a metaphor there. And if you go into the old books of Magick, the grimoires, like the Greater and Lesser Keys of Solomon, you will determine that at that level, the 72 fallen angels from the Lamegaton that Enoch talks about with Raziel, the archangel that gave him the names of the demons, you say the reason that book is left out of the Bible, most Bibles, not all, is because it gives you the names of demons, which means that that's how you can control them. If you have their name, that's what all exorcism is about, to determine the name, the demon's name, Rumpelstiltskin by any other name. And once you have that, you have control of the demon. And if you look at the old Babylonian star maps, where those sigils came from, the 72 fallen, you'll find that they each represented qualities in man that were not deemed worthy, like greed, jealousy, anger, you know, and the rest of it. It's all metaphor. And it's not about, you know, God's battling anything. God's not at war with anything. I mean, you know, he is, and that's it. He is, period. And so it is man that polarizes it. Let me give you an example. This Christmas, my girlfriend, I have a two-story home, and I work on the second floor, and she strung Christmas lights out on my patio, out on my deck, so that I would enjoy them while I'm riding. Now, because they were behind, I can see them from my home, but if you drove up from my driveway, you would not see them. They were not put up for other people. They were, because I live in the woods where nobody else cares, because nobody else is there. And so it's for my own pleasure, and that's why she put them up. Now, the question is, are they real or are they not real? They're both. And that's where God comes in, as beyond man's comprehension.
Fair.
By definition, that's what God would be. In my universe, you know.
Yeah.
Some truths.
Well said. So talk to us about power tools and your time teaching super soldiers to better hone their psychic abilities and ESP and all the different experiences that led up to writing that book.
So it all started with my little girl dying of leukemia when I was 60 years old. I was set for life. I never had to work again. I had my own paid for savings, had some incomes. And when she got ill with leukemia, they took everything of mine. And when she died at age 60, I had like Social Security only for incomes. Oh, yeah. The reason I don't have a pension is because I was a GS-18. I was a gunslinger for the Navy outside. That means I get Medicare and Social Security. And like, that's not enough to live on.
No.
And I had, that's why I'm 72 and I'm writing again. So Nick Begich came down and knew about me, and we became friends, and he brought me up to Saskatoon and had me write the ESP induction through forms of self-hypnosis. That was the first protocol that I trained SEAL units 1, 2, and 3 with. After that, you know, thinking with the gut, that thing that I do with Matt Stein now on urban survival skill workshops. That's how I support myself, is writing and trying to do workshops. And it's a struggle, you know, and at my age, at 72, it's a struggle, you know. So buy my books, you know, because that, well, that gives you an exchange and it takes care of my needs. I'm simple. The problem is that money isn't really real. What's, you know, it's just like a theatrical prop. What's real is labor. When you actually do something. And so my little girl dying was actually a good thing. And I had closings with her when she died in my arms, because it has forced me to write again. And I have discovered that writing is my joy. The reason I do radio is to promote my writings, because once you read what I'm having to say, you'll get it. And then you'll want some of the other areas. And the problem is, most people can't make a living at writing. But I'm a polymath, and so I'm going to write in several areas. And so I write in Jungian psychotherapy. I write in agriculture as the postman. And I write in my memories of what I did when I was a physicist, with books like Spook Central and The Non-Local Mind in a Holographic Universe, How to Change That Movie. The Power Tools came in second. It was on the 8 protocols. The first one was ESP, Thinking with the Gut. The second book is on the 8 protocols that were basically power tools. Foods, you know, that you would eat that are like superfoods. Breathing techniques so that you could change your perception of time and change your martial arts so that it verged on paranormal. You know, look, experiencing it with the precision of Tai Chi when you're doing Hung Gao puts you in world-class boxing right out of the gate. And so there are very few people that even know how to do that technique. That is world-class quality in boxing. Working with instinct and slowing down your perception of time so that you have the precision. And it has higher levels of consciousness. And so what I did is I wrote that for the world. These are things I did 45 years ago. These are how they work. Now, what I'm doing in The Non-Local Mind, which is not yet in print, which is the third book in the series, is basically How to Change the Movie. The brain can rightly be seen as a four-dimensional hologram of 5 space. It's liquid crystal phases, so it's constantly changing, like the DNA is a three-dimensional hologram of 4 space, who you were, who you are, and will be, as a metaphor. And the brain, because of liquid crystal phases and amorphous semiconductors, like the temporal lobes, that allows the brain to be properly seen as a four-dimensional hologram in 5 space. It's constantly changing with time, which allows the option of sliders and being able to change the movie by purposefully meditating in certain manners. And that's what I'm writing about now. And literally, I have discovered chapter 6 is titled Rock the Casimir or Adventures in Time Travel. And once you get the interconnectivity of it all, and why you would choose to find significance on one thing over another, that's the first step toward the next level of evolution.
Hmm. Now let me read a little bit from the material that you gave me. You say that when I could not find answers in my physics, I began to study metaphysics. That led me to study magic, mostly considered to be tomorrow's physics, which is where I encountered archetypes and their use as a tool for overview outcomes. The Greek pantheon was chosen as being more accessible than the more obscure Egyptian animal-like gods. If we could identify which gods were dominating in your life, we could then better project the outcomes. Can you elaborate on that last sentence a bit?
Well, it's like going from binary logic into object-oriented, where you start grouping, and you have the paths going from Chicago to Minneapolis, and you take it route wise by Route 66 or whatever. And there are 22 basic stories in the big city, the way the Greeks did it. I chose a Greek pantheon because it was more human. Egyptian mythology, Ra and Horus and those guys, but you know, they're more instinctual and on an animalistic level and are more difficult in a current society to associate and metaphor with. However, Hermes, who's Hermes in Greek mythology? Well, he's the guy that when you go to Greece, you hire to translate for you. He's not the message. He's the translator. Who's the magician? Who's the Hierophant? Hierophant! A Hierophant is that guy that old wise magicians send in to check to see if it's a minefield. They're the guys that go in where angels fear to tread. Metaphor. You know, they're like a young magician. A Hierophant is a young magician, like a full-bird colonel. They don't make it, general. Well, that's how it works, like two-star generals and four-star generals. Two-star generals and full-bird colonels are about the same in the military. They're the Hierophant, part of the higher, you know, command center, whatever.
Right. So how can we identify what gods might be dominating in our own lives to better project future outcomes?
So you look at it through stories. And that's why I use the Greek pantheon, because Psyche at the Well has an ending. And once you realize that your psyche, in this, you're enacting that god in your life, do you like the ending? And so maybe you want to change things, you know. Who knows? Why I say it like that is that, and by the way, I'm impressed with the quality of your astuteness in questions. They're interesting.
Thanks.
And I'm impressed. Just thought I would mention that.
Appreciate it.
Well, just suck it up, man. You're only 30. I can only guess where you're going to be when you're 60.
Shit.
Yeah. There's not like me. What in the hell is that? How did it go? Live from New York. It's
Saturday night.
Okay. So you have options of either being, in psychology, they say that you are either possessed or you're complex. You can't get out of it alive. You're possessed means you have only one story going on. And complex means there's more than one god involved in your life. There's a complex or several gods, several stories interwoven that create a fabric. And so you're either complex or you're possessed. For the greater good. It's all part of inner vision and dialogue with your higher self. That's what you're trying to achieve here. And when you get that, that's called self-realization. And that is knowledge and conversation and magic. It's the same thing where you can talk to your angel like I'm talking to you right now.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, in Jungian psychotherapy, they would say I am your angel, and I'm just a reflection in the physical world, and the whole way of doing it, radio, whatever, is a hallucination in your way of comprehending the dialogue. That's how bad it is with ego.
Wow, man.
Yeah, I'm trying to give you the image.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
You know, it's a tool. Yeah, so that you can actually now, as a metaphor, use this as a way to approach things. How did they used to say it? Things always work out in the end. If things are not working out, it's not yet the end.
Boom.
That's your cavitation ball between your past and your future. These are, they don't exist. Timelines are arbitrary. Which one do you want to incorporate in consciousness? And if you do that, that's where in the movie Interstellar, when he went through the dark, you know, the black hole, and is that somewhere in the Akashic records where all these different timelines of are sliding by in the library, and he looks for the one where his daughter is walking into the library, and then he pushes books out at her in his attempt to communicate.
Mm-hmm.
It's a metaphor, again, of seeing how time and the future have arbitrary timelines. He knew previously she was not afraid of the popping out as poltergeist, but felt it was something else trying to talk to her.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how he then tried to talk to her in the future.
Right. Yeah, and on the subject of
as
magic
a metaphor.
Right. And on the subject of magic and timelines, you know, something I've been wondering, why are astrological charts so damn accurate?
Because over the centuries, they have evolved into a bull being very stubborn and a Pisces going in two directions like I do. As a metaphor, you know, astronomy is our new science from astrology, sort of like alchemy became chemistry. That is the basic distortion of our consciousness, trying to form a metaphor of, gee, that's kind of like this, isn't it? And when you do that, it sets up timelines. And you can go back and change them. Like when you do a Skype and I send you a text message and I see that I made a mistake, I have a brief two messages where I can hit the edit button and go back in and recorrect my typos. And I believe I did that several times with you to show you that metaphor.
Right on. Man, a lot of information for sure. You mentioned you've been doing a lot of work on urban survival. Are these skills you think we're going to need as the empire collapses?
Well, even if you don't, it's about empowerment.
True.
The very fact that you are so dependent on water from your municipality that if the grid went out, and it won't or it might, and you actually can count on it, it is here with me with telephones and communication right now, so there it is. And we don't even have an earthquake yet. So here we are with the end of days, and you're here to witness how it all plays out for yourself. And you have, as God's favor, choice to see if your glass is half full or half empty. And if it's half empty, you then, oh, look what I just lost. I don't have any internet and I don't have any. Or you see it, it's half full. We're still doing the interview easily over a cell phone. And when that half full glass fell over this edge and broke, I looked over the edge and guess what? It was already half fixed.
Hmm.
You have choice in the way you choose to see what's going on. And at the end of the day is what is meant to happen. Whether you did it kicking and screaming and fighting and creating karma and anger and piss and vinegar, or you were like Buddha and allowed the mountain to come to you. Unfortunately, Buddha didn't realize that was going to be an earthquake. The mountain fell on him. Just kidding.
It's metaphor.
Yeah, you want to have joy in the way you see things, even when they go south. Is that, you know, south is where there's more heat, so that doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be a cold and bumpy ride.
So obviously we got to stay optimistic, but what sort of earth changes do you see happening in the next 5 to 10 years?
All of them. Anything, yeah. Pandemics, all of it. They had this movie that just came out called The Fifth Wave. Did you see that?
I didn't see The Fifth Wave.
Okay, well, it's a must-see, trust me. Why? The alien craft arrives. It looks something like out of Independence Day, and it just sits there for a couple of months without doing anything. And all of a sudden, the first wave hits. It is an EMP strike dropping the Earth down into the Stone Age. The third wave is a pandemic where across the world, people start dying from weird diseases. The fifth wave is kind of like Rwanda, where they teach our children to go down and do mop-up on remaining survivors.
Hmm.
And the movie's Hollywood, so how's that sound? You can count on it. In the movie, it's Hollywood. They always have to have a good ending, right? So they did the children figure it out. And it's like in the movie V, where all the aliens in their blue coats and, you know, tie collars
right.
have to march back up in their spaceship and go home. But it won't work like that. It will work the way you want it to.
Well, when you want to see what's coming, look at Hollywood, right?
Yeah, that's why I did this thing down in Hollywood to start the program, man. Yes, it's in time to wake up and stop being so ignorant, ill-informed, or complacent. You need to start making plans for yourself and internal work and becoming a little more independent of Donald Trump. Yeah, because that's going to go really bad. Trust me.
Mm.
You know, when Hillary Clinton is his, you know, adversary, she and what she did was the last person that did what she did. Literally, they executed her. It was a woman, and they electrocuted her. And that's what should happen to Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. A president is supposed to represent our most scholarly and educated and refined with values. Trump is a little brat, spoiled brat, that while is not purchasable, his ego is out of control. And let me tell you, they can profile that so he doesn't have to be part of the club and still be with the boys from Brazil. Trust me.
Mm.
And Trump is so ignorant, he doesn't have a clue where Hillary is an outright criminal.
Yes.
And so here we are at the end of days with several puppets as your choice for representing the very finest from the United States. That's what I see happening. And I can candidly say this is no longer the country I served and protected. It is an embarrassment.
Yeah. Oops, looks like I lost him. One sec here. All right, Doc, I got you back.
My track phone ran out of time.
No worries. I understand that. But I did want to get, before I really let you go, I wanted to give you a couple minutes to just tell the people about your books and get a chance to plug your websites and stuff. And then I can stitch it all together later.
Okay. You can find all of my books at RichardAllenMiller.com. I'm Miller, Allen, A-L-A-N. So I'm RichardAllenMiller.com. Or my publishing site, which is oak-publishing.com. And finally, if you go to my Facebook blog at docram.com. And here comes CenturyLink, just down. That means that I'm not even going to have internet now, and I have to go meet the truck. They are interfering with me across the board.
Ah, it is a shame, but I do appreciate your time, man. It's been a lot of fun. Are there any urban survival courses coming up or anything like that?
Yes, but I'm no longer able to talk about them. I have to go deal with this truck. This is how they mess with me.
Mm.
I'm sorry.
All right, take care.
Yeah, bye-bye.
All right, people, there we go. Please wait for the ride to come to a complete stop. Don't lift the lap bar just yet, but man, definitely an interesting guy and an interesting show, to say the least, and a take on magic and entities that's a little bit different than most. But 72, and with a laundry list of cool experiences and impressive connections and interesting thoughts, I'm happy he was here. In the Plus Show, we keep on wrestling with the weird. We get into Dr. Miller's thoughts about the Rh negative factor, Morgellons, a sentient AI that was birthed onto the internet accidentally by SETI, the Nazi base the good doctor was privileged enough to see firsthand after a research trip down there on bioluminescence, the idea of beings inside the Earth, water-based computer chips and the hidden value of water, Planet X and the possible second solar system, scalar physics and biological amplification, the list goes on. Fascinating guy. And I hope some of you will be intrigued enough to dig deeper into his books and website, very vast in topics and scope. I had a good time with him, though. I just wish we had a little bit longer and maybe could have gotten more into the details. But just like every week, please sign up for Plus to hear more. It really helps the show thrive, and you're really only getting half the show. I mean, there is a lot more on the plate. Consider some of your favorite shows. If THC is one of them, imagine missing out on half of them. You know, you don't hear it, so you don't realize it or think about it in that way, but really, you're only getting 50% of the show. Remember, you also get access to download all the Higher Side Chats ending music tracks and access to the Plus Members Forum, where we talk about all kinds of things. And I just added an entrepreneurs thread where THC Plus members can talk about their personal attempts to get out of the rat race and potentially find some like-minded customers. I know several people have been taking to that thread already. Also, as promised, I'm trying to get a quick boost of 50 subscribers to help pay for some detailed professional show notes. I've never really approached a cost of the show by directly looking to meet a goal of a certain number of subscribers, but it's an expensive process. And once we get the show notes, we really can't go back. So I want to make sure there's enough money every month to pay for it, and a nice 50 subscriber bump would do that. I mentioned it last week, and we didn't really get as big of a bump as I hoped, only about 15 since the last show. So if you've been thinking about it, please pull the trigger. The sign-up process has been refined, as well as the step-by-step instructions for Android users. We got the iPhone app now. I'm doing what I can to stay on top of the game, but we live in a pay-to-play world. There have been some listeners who have commented that they wanted to sign up for Plus but didn't want to sign up for recurring payments. I understand that. And I don't say this on the air very often because I just forget, but there are several non-recurring payment options. You can throw down $15 for 90 days or pick up 6 months or 12 months at a time. So I try to be as flexible as possible. I even take checks and money orders. I'm not looking to set up roadblocks between you and Plus. I'm really looking to get as many people on the Plus program as possible because it's best for the listeners and for the guests and, of course, for myself in the show. And yeah, this is a little bit of a harder sell than usual because I really do want to get those show notes done, and it's the last piece of the puzzle. And I think it's a great resource for following up on things discussed on the show because this really is an information-heavy podcast, so I want to have those show notes dialed in. It was also my birthday this week, so let's pile on another reason. If there's anything I want, it's just for you to enjoy the full shows and sign up for THC+. Treat yourself. You deserve it. Also, our buddy Crow has launched his podcast. I gotta mention that. I was the second guest, so hop over to crow777radio.com and check that out. I think I'm a better host than I am a guest, but he said people are liking it, so I'll take it. I'm also going to be doing a second Q&A show for the Plus members really soon, so add some more questions to that forum thread if you want to ask me anything. I'll be doing it this month in April. And the last bit of news, the big Conspiraties clearance sale is going on now. Some of the shirts are up to like $9 off, which is basically half price. And they won't be printed again in a lot of cases, so jump on that. I will be doing shirts still, but we're not going to be doing Conspiraties. I'm losing the Conspiraties brand. I think I got some better ideas, and I'm constantly fighting off people who are violating the patent trademark. And I just don't want to be that guy. You're going to be fighting people forever with a pun name like that. We're going to move on. But the point is, it's a hell of a deal right now. Go to conspiraties.net and pick yourself up something nice. Of course, I'll be picking a Money Bomb winner for this month tomorrow, the 29th. I am a little bit behind on shows, backed up to the last couple days of the month, but I do have one just about ready. Should be here soon, and at least by the 31st. You're going to like it too. It's fairly unique. But anyway, tomorrow is the 29th. Watch your emails. If you are picked as the Money Bomb winner, good luck. Hope you enjoyed Richard Allen Miller. He's quite a trip. But that's it for me today. I'll talk to you guys soon. Your move, sentient AI of the SETI screensavers. Your fucking move.
Oh no. You see, the world is attached to puppet strings, control over everything. The 9 to 5 is trying to steal ya. Now don't that job seem silly? Hello, can you hear me? Or should I play back recordings from some spy agency? Wish we were younger and free. I'll be thankful when it's all exposed, the vast conspiracy. There's such a difference between us and the dead brothers. Doubling your time.